We on earth understand God with our earthly understanding. We understand Him through our mind, through our imagination, through our books and other things where He is described as such and such. There is a big, big mystery. God and His divine power. It's a big mystery, mystery for all the human beings. And you cannot conceive it with your limited mind. The working of God's divine power is also very mysterious. Whatever we call mysterious means that it is beyond our mind. We cannot conceive it in our mind. His power of love is very mysterious. What we think is love is not the way He loves us. Or His power of compassion, His power of forgiveness is extremely mysterious for us because we are so imperfect. Because of our imperfection, we cannot understand a person who is absolute, who is perfect. When we see Him, we see through our imperfections. And that's how we form our ideas according to our own imperfections about God. Say for a small little ant, if you have to convey the political issue that is facing Britain today, is it possible? Because for the poor little ant, it is not even conceivable that we have a mind which thinks, which has imagination, which projects like an octopus, goes all round, catches this, catches that. It cannot even understand that we have a kind of a freedom by which we can do what we like. The conception cannot be contained in that little mind or little head of that tiny creature. But the difference between an ant and a human being is that ant has no ego. Now the problem with human beings is that despite the same co-relationship, or we can say despite the same parallel as a human being and God, an ant and man, to top the whole thing is the ego part, which in a way makes us even lower than an ant. Because our reception is so poor that we cannot see that there must be something mysterious about God. God has to be a mystery for human beings. And to understand the mystery, we have to enter into a new realm. More than what we can really understand with this human awareness, there has to be another plane from which we should try to see this mystery, because we cannot understand anything about it, how He does it. I mean, see now, in chemistry, if you see the periodical laws that exist, it's fantastic, absolutely fantastic. Look at a little amoeba, how it acts, and look at small animals who live in the rivers and who live in the seas. The number of creatures that are living harmoniously, not like human beings, but quite harmoniously, accepting each other's demand, even on their life. So with this freedom, and such a big mystery, and a big ego in between, it's difficult for us to conceive His greatness, His compassion, His love. That whatever He does is for the betterment of our spirit. Even if He kills someone, it is for the betterment of the spirit. Even if He thrashes someone and throws him down many hills, it is for the betterment of the spirit. When He puts you to problems and troubles, it is for the betterment of your spirit. Anything that happens to you is a testing ground for the betterment of your spirit. He is working day in and day out just to improve your awareness in your spirit, to feel your spirit. Everything, the nature, the beauty, everything is working it out so that you, the human beings, should feel His beauty, should know Him in your own awareness, should feel the vibrant love of God. For ages it has been worked out, imagine, since this world was created till today, with various incarnations who came on this earth to represent Him, to talk about Him, to work about Him, to improve our different centers within us. And then suddenly, when we are placed face to face, we can't believe that it can happen. It is a mixture of, I think, ego and superego both. First of all, we cannot believe ourselves that we are capable of getting realization. And secondly, I think that we are afraid to get realized. Thirdly, we do not trust anyone who talks of realization. The third one is a good idea, not to trust him. But at least trust yourself. You start from that point. You trust yourself that you should get your realization. Otherwise, why do you call yourself a seeker? You have to get your realization, no doubt about it. But when it comes to trust, whom do we trust? Say, for example, when Christ said that God is my Father, He has sent me specially to do this work, we couldn't believe it. This man is son of a carpenter talking like this. Better crucify him. And our compassion went to a confirmed thief than to the adoration of the Son of God. Now, when he is dead, of course, he is Son of God, there is Holy Ghost, everything starts. I mean, when he is no more, then people start believing. I don't know why they even today believe that he was Son of God. Why do they believe even the Holy Ghost? I mean, even the Bible, why should we believe it? What is the authority of Bible? I mean, Islam can ask that question, a Muslim can ask a question, what is the authority of Bible, why do you believe in Bible? I mean, if you take out the Bible, they say, what is the authority? They may say, Christ is the authority. But Christ never wrote Bible. So what is the authority? Is your own ego. You want to believe in it. You want to believe in it. That's all. You want to believe in it. That helps you to sort out many questions. Because anything happens, you say, all right, it's God's wish. Because we can use him better when he was crucified. Before that we cannot use him because he was independent. He was living there. When he died, it's very handy, so we accept him. We do not question. So was that a mistake for him to say that he was the Son of God? Do you think it was a mistake that Christ said that he was the Son of God? Because of that he was crucified. Do you think it was a mistake that he said the truth about himself? Would you say that? How can you justify his saying that? See, if he was crucified for that, then he was indiscriminate. One would say that to say such a thing. This was no discrimination. It was not wise to say, after all, he would have lived longer. He would have spent better time with his mother. He could have built a house or something like that. He would have amassed some money or some sort of a very important thing he would have done. But there's the mystery. That's the mystery we do not know. Because we want to see it from our angle, and at a point we just give it up. We don't justify, then we do not rationalize it. At a point we just give up, oh, it's all right, he's God. With each a point there we say, all right, he was Son of God, let him, whatever he wanted, he did, whatever he thought proper. How are we to judge him? But now, not when he lived. I must say, God is a mystery, but human beings are greater mystery than God. To me, at least. I mean, they know how far to go and how to switch off suddenly to something, oh, that's divine. Up to a point, they go on rationalizing, intellectualizing, and then they say, oh, that's divine, finished. None of you have seen him walking on the water, did you? Nor he being resurrected, none of you have. So why should we believe that he did that? It's a question we should ask ourselves. But he did. And that he was the Son of God. But how are we to believe into it? You have to become something more to know the mystery of his life. Why he crucified himself? Why he accepted that life? And why, with all his powers that he is going to come to destroy the whole world now, why did he not destroy these people who were trying to crucify him? What was the role he had to play in his lifetime? We cannot understand it with this human awareness. You have to become something more. And that's why he again and again said, you are to be born again. How many of us think that we are to be born again? Are we born again? We certify, many people certify, I am born again, I am a Christian. Meaning born again, isn't it? Muslim means the same. And Brahmin means the same, those who are born again. Now how are you born? Again, is again a make-belief that I am born again, self-certification, walking around with a certificate that human beings giving the certificate to human beings. So where is the truth? But if you are ardently seeking the truth, then the mysteries can be opened to you. But you have to seek the truth. And truth alone, and nothing else. If you want to live with your ego, go ahead. Nobody can change. When you start seeing your ego, you have to know that this is not yourself, something beyond. Because through ego, whatever you have known is all a chaos. All that knowledge that you got through ego is creating all the problems of the world. All the fears you have gathered through your superego is another disaster for human beings. There must be something that God must have put within us, some light by which we can see something beyond our ego and superego. Unless and until that happens to you, you cannot understand the mystery of God and His love. You cannot understand. Human love has no depth to feel the depth of God's love and His heart. He is so self-centered. He is so ego-oriented. His heart has to melt open. It has to melt completely and flow. This frozen heart is like an iceberg, has to be dissolved in the ocean of His love. Otherwise you can never get to the depths of His love. The people write to me, "Mother, I am not in love with some and some. And so how can I be happy with that person? That person will be miserable." Now you are living with that person for years. You are having children from that person. You don't love. You don't love anyone. You cannot love. You don't know what love is. They fall into love, you see. Fall in. Some sort of a thing for them is love. I don't know. What is love for human beings? To be very frank, I don't understand. Here they fall in love and next day they are out to the courts. And according to them, falling in love is something, you see, out of the blue. "Oh, I have fallen in love," you see. That. I have yet to come across a person who has really fallen in love. Because as soon as something comes up, that companionship and that love, that enjoyment of oneness vanishes. Heart has to melt. Hearts must meet where they have no stones in between. Otherwise, these stony hearts will just break each other. Imagine two stones trying to meet each other, loving each other. How can they love? I can't understand. It's a big mystery that human beings know how to live with artificiality and with false beliefs. They compromise. But spirit does not compromise with anything. It does not. It forgives because it loves. It just forgives, goes on forgiving, forgiving, because it loves. And then it punishes also because it loves. And it destroys also because it loves. That's the spirit has to shine through your self-realization. Talking big about self-realization, pay 100 rupees, get your self-realization, all this nonsense is at such a low ebb and such a horrid thing. That the beauty of His mystery is just left alone. You are in the chamber of a Satan to believe in these things. Here, in the kingdom of God, there is forgiveness. There is love. There is compassion. There is understanding. There is complete, all-pervading assurance and a support and a hand that wants to raise you. An anxious father who wants to soothe you, to give you joy, to give you eternal joy. Can you think of someone like that in this world? He has problems, many problems. He has problems. But the greatest problem is that he cannot have a rapport with his own children. That he cannot give what he wants to give to his children, who have a heart which has no emptiness, which cannot be filled like a cup with his love. Kundalini does that suction in our heart, no doubt. But first she enters into the brain, into the limbic area. And then it proceeds towards heart. So this mystery is solved once we start engulfing our brain, our thoughts, our thinking, completely drenched in the showers of His grace. Otherwise, the spiky mind can never receive those beautiful dews of love which fall, these dewdrops. You have to be a flower to receive. A very soft, tender, receptive person. And then only the fruit appears when you mature a heart of a saint, which is larger than all the oceans of the world. Such wisdom of enjoying one's own love, just that love that flows. This mystery I wish all of you could achieve in this life. Give up your ideas of judging something on gross levels. You have to become subtler. Try to enjoy things. Do not be joy killers. And you will get the benefit of this. In such immeasurable quantities. Try to receive. Receive more of the grace. Drench yourself. It's so soothing. It is the energy that soothes you. Can you think of energy that soothes your mind completely? That gives you wisdom. That coordinates the whole atmosphere to make you happy? This divine energy is all-pervading, and to understand the mystery of that all-pervading power, you have to become self-realized. You have to be born again. This is not the way out. And to mature after this rebirth. It's easy to make fun of someone, very easy. But what did you get all these days making fun? Now you are here to get really something substantial. Better have it. Thank you very much. Today I would request you to ask me some questions because it's a still time and it would be better if you ask some questions today. Some questions? David?
That's it. You shouldn't get so serious about it. What's the matter? Are you not all right?
Well,
we'll be all right. You just put your left hand up like that. Left. Yeah. No, left, I think. You see, when they feel heated, Sahaja Yogis, they get upset. Just put left or right and see that it works out. Ventilate yourself. It's all right. Take it easy. It's all clearing out. Better?
Yes, sir.
What is there to be upset? I see your face. It's like that also. Very simple. You just see when you are ventilating. Or if you do not want to do it in the presence of others, you can put the hand down below like that. Or like that. Just sit down like this. You can feel it. People have objection. The new people always have an objection if you put even hands like this. They say, why? So is there any question?
If you do feel the cool breeze in your hand,
If
one doesn't feel the cool breeze in the hand.
You did feel, na?
No, so far I haven't felt.
You haven't felt at all? Not at all?
No, I felt tingling and things like that, but not
tingling. Still?
Yes, I mean even today my thumb was tingling.
This thumb?
Yes.
Put your right hand like this. Yeah. You are a doctor, isn't it?
Yes. It's not that my profession is coming in between.
Could be. You see, when we are doctors, we treat them physically, the patients. But patients are, say, if they are suffering from tuberculosis, say leprosy or anything, we are very much worried, you see, to disinfect everything, we use gloves, this, that. But these patients come with mental problems. And we have no way of protecting ourselves from that. And we share them very much more than any other infection in the world. If you go in a lunatic asylum and stay there for 2 days, you'll become a lunatic. That's what it is, absolutely. So, mental problems are to be understood of a patient. Because doctors treat physically, psychologists treat mentally, others treat. I mean, as I said, that there's one doctor for one and another for the other.
It's very unfortunate.
Is it? No integration. And no understanding among themselves. Now, even I've seen that psychologists, when they treat patients, I mean, really, they're putting their hands into the mouth of a serpent. They don't know how they are affected. They don't know what happens to them. That's why they're so perverted. I mean, Freud, you can explain, because you see, you must have been contaminated with all kinds of problematic people, you know, very pathological people. And when these people come to you, you try to sort of cure them. You cannot. Because they are absolutely off people, you see. But you try to build them up, and this is all artificial sort of thing. You try with them. And what you do is to exchange that disease, or to also share it. And then, that's why these psychologists, when they write, they look so abnormal, because they always meet abnormal people. They never meet normal people. So to them, you see, everything, it's like Freud had, everything is sex. I mean, any normal person will say, what's that? How could it be? So that's what happens with the patients. That's why I said, could be your profession. Because you meet all kinds of people. Sometimes, what we call very physical troubles are starting from the mental, very much actually, even cancer. You'll be amazed that I have now treated many cancer patients and have not come across one of them, even one of them, whose problem doesn't start from the left side, meaning the mental problem. So you'll be surprised that cancer is actually the base of it is a mental problem. Now the doctors have said that they saw some proteins attacking and triggering cancer. And these proteins they call as protein 58 and some names they give. And these are living proteins, they enter into us into our awareness, and they live within us in areas which are unknown to us since creation. They have said it now. But this I said about at least 10 or 11 years back, what are these areas, from where they come, how they attack us. But this is the setting of chance and how the triggering takes place.
It's obviously some changes are taking place in the cellular structure.
Yes, there must be something that triggers it. But the left side, or the side which we call as the side which has to do with our emotions. Now the trouble is, doctors also do not consider left and right sympathetic nervous system are two different systems. They think they are one. I mean, so far they do not know that they are absolutely two different systems and they work separately. But because they are so connected, you see, that you feel that both are one, but they are not. In Sahaja Yoga you can find out that there are two systems and work separately. One is for emotions and another for physical and mental activity. And this must be the reason. You just put your left hand and you will be better off, I think, and right hand like this. Now, new people, who are they? Good. Did you feel any cool breeze?
Sorry?
Did you feel any cool breeze in the hand?
The last time I came, yes.
You did feel?
But I wondered whether that was just sort of water suggestion, you know, with people saying that, you know, you should expect a cool breeze, so I just thought maybe, you know, it's mind over matter. That was what I thought.
But just put your hands like this. I'll tell you what a cool breeze is, all right?
Mm-hmm.
When you become subtler personality,
mm-hmm.
See, it is everywhere. This is all pervading power. You don't feel it normally. But when you become subtler, then only this feeling starts coming in. And that is the proof that you have become subtler. You even start feeling the cool breeze coming from here. That's the proof that you have become subtler. That means you are twice born, according to us. Because that is the sign of a realization. Now, it's written in the Bible also that one feels the cool breeze of the Holy Ghost, you see. Cool breeze of the Holy Ghost. But Bible is a mystery of mystery. Because first of all, they never allowed Christ to live long. I mean, he could only work for 4 years, can you imagine? 4 years I was struggling with 6 Sahaja Yogis in London. 4 years I was struggling with 6 of them. I must say Christ at least had 12 of them. He was better off. He could not though give them realization. He was being fed up. And this is what it is. And then to explain all the mysteries, I mean, you cannot put your foot anywhere. See, you don't understand their limitations. If they say anything, everybody is sitting there. You said so? All right, catch hold of it. Did you say so? All right. This is. As if, you know, everybody is feeling attacked. There's such a lot of fear is in human mind is that anybody says anything which is truth, they can't bear, they can't bear the truth. In Sahaja Yoga also there are mysteries. Everybody doesn't know everything in the beginning. Gradually they come to know. In the beginning, everybody does not know everything. Because it's difficult for human beings to bear the truth. It's not that I have any fear from you, that if you know anything about me, I'll have any problems. Because, thank God, you cannot crucify me this time. But I have a fear about you because you'll be upset. You will be upset, not it's me. You will be upset. Oh, that's the truth. So the Sahaja Yogis are prohibited from telling much about me. Better talk about Sahaja Yoga, Kundalini, this, that. Because people get upset about it. Now, just put your hands like this. Just like this. Put your both of your feet. Now, it's a spontaneous happening, has to happen. If it does not happen, then there's a problem. And that problem is to be corrected. And there are ways and methods of correcting. Now, for that, you have to first of all see where is the problem is. Now, those who are realized souls have got this flow of this energy in them. Now, if they move their hand even like this, they say, oh, they were doing hands like these. If they have to move, I mean, supposing there's a screw that is to be driven in, you have to drive in the screw, isn't it? You have to do something about it. That is also objectionable for people. You see, you should sit here, transfixed, If they try to do anything, then people run away. We have had such horrible experiences of these running away people. We call them bhagedu in our language. You see, bhagedu means those who always run, take on the run, who are always on the run. That if somebody tries to raise the kundalini also, they say, oh, see, these are mad people. They just run. They just want to hear what they want to hear. They have their own conceptions and they want to see those conceptions being said to them, just pampering them. But that's not the truth. Somebody has to tell you the truth and people are not willing for it. It's a big problem to talk to people. They'll go on asking you questions after questions. Then what is this? Then how is it? Why is it Mataji alone? That's very common in England. Why Mataji? I said, you do it please, for God's sake. I'll be very happy. I would like to retire. But why is it me? Better ask God if Almighty, why is it me? But if it is me, I have to bear the cross. What to do? Why it was Christ? I mean, you could have been better that way, some people can say. That any one of you could have been better than Christ. Could be, might be. But why not? So you come to the point that you cannot explain everything in the beginning. If you do, you get upset. People get upset. So just we say, all right, see, now first of all, let it be. First, feel the cool breeze. If that cool breeze is there, then we'll talk about it later. All right? So step by step we move. First of all, you must feel the cool breeze. Otherwise, the other day I was reading an article about, because these people had taken a bath or some bath, they were sitting and meditating. So the lady had a big objection to the bath. I mean, what is the harm if they have to meditate in bath? What does it matter? If you meditate in a palace, they will say, oh, these people are all sitting in a palace. All right. If you are sitting in a bath, they say, they are sitting in a bath. What do? You hang in the air? They'll say, they were hanging there. I mean, you have to be something, isn't it? Like some of them had an objection, why should she be an Indian? She could have been English. Baba, what to do? I became an Indian. I had to be something, isn't it? It's such a helpless condition. You don't know what to do with yourself. This is the problem. And this is what happens. That's why I say you first get your cool breeze. Alright? Then we'll talk about it. Now this you cannot get by yourself, can you? You cannot. By thinking, can you? No. So you should get your cool breeze. That's the first condition of Sahaja Yoga. If you do not get your cool breeze, then you are not yet started understanding. This is the first thing that should happen, you get your cool breeze. Then maintain it. Then go further. Alright? So we have to see if you are getting the cool breeze or not. Then we'll talk about it later. Are you? Not yet. What about you? Look at this. We should be. So, are you a Jew? No. Or a Christian? Which one? You have been a Catholic or a
Protestant?
Hmm?
Protestant.
Protestant. Everyone did some sort of a mistake, no doubt. You can feel it here, you see. Just feel your forehead here. You can feel with your left hand. Yeah, higher. See, there's a lump. Is there? Can you feel? That's it. That's the problem. It will work out. Just rub it. Rub it out. Are you better, doctor? Just put it. Put this hand. Stiff. You are not well, doctor. You have to have some treatment. All right? You are not normal according to Sahaja Yoga. You need this treatment. All right? So I'll tell you what treatment we have to give you for this.
Mother, somebody said to me the other day that it was dangerous to it could be dangerous rather to raise it from the lead. Now, could you explain to us why it says
not
it's a hard job?
This is, you see, it would be dangerous for anyone to do something which they do not know. For example, if somebody says car driving is dangerous, it would be for a person like me. I've never driven a car, you see. Next moment you'll find me sitting on a tree and the car is absolutely, I tell you, I can't drive even one inch. So with such a person, if I say car driving is the most dangerous thing, should you accept that? The same thing. Somebody has to know the job. First of all, it's a divine work. It's the work of God Almighty. Such a person has to be a holy person. Has to be an honest person. Has to be divine. Otherwise, it doesn't work out. If you are not a holy person, can you raise the Kundalini, which is the holiest of holy within you? She doesn't understand unholy people. She doesn't like them. So, such a person has to be something that. That's why it is difficult for these people who want to make money out of Kundalini awakening. Like some people might say that to sprout a seed is the most difficult thing. You have to pull out the seed and you have to pull out the primule. But for a farmer, it's a very common knowledge that you put it under the mother's care. The mother earth looks after the seed. Very simple. She knows the job. One has to know the job. And those who do not know, they try all kinds of tricks, which is unauthorized, unholy, and sinful. That's why they suffer. But to me, it is sahaja. To me, it is absolutely my nature. I'm Kundalini addict, you can say. In modern terminology, or you can say that, what else? I don't know what other words you use, I'm not so modern. But a sort of the whole attention in a person I have is of Kundalini. I don't know a person otherwise. The face-wise, I don't recognize people so much as I know from their Kundalini. So, it's a different plane into which you just go. After Kundalini awakening takes place, then your attention also becomes, you see, so subtle that you can see Kundalini around. You can. If there's a clear sky, you can see Kundalini's around. You can. And you start seeing the Kundalini of people and feeling it. I mean, not with the eyes, but you start really feeling them. All around, you just go about like that. Like my own two grandchildren who have come now are realized soul. So today somebody came in, and they came and told in my ears, that this man has a bad stomach, ask him to go to bathroom. So I asked the fellow, have you got pain in the stomach? He says, terrible. I said, you better go to the bathroom, the girls are saying you'll be better off. And he had a big motion. He felt very much better. Now these two girls worked on the fellow in such a miraculous way. He did not know. He said, I was having a terrible pain. And when I came here, it was even worse. They told me. They're little girls. One is 9, another is about 5. And they did it. Now, there's a nice announcement I would like to make, that we are having a nice music program on. Kevin will tell about the program. Pure classical Indian music, which will be good from Sahaja Yoga point of view also. Because you can use these notes for transmitting vibrations. And it's very simple to do that. And I would request all the Sahaja Yogis to attend this program. And we are going to have dinner after that together. And I hope, Kuli, have you fixed the hall? Is he there?
No, he's not there, but I think he has.
Is that? So will you tell them, Kavin, what time it is and where?
concert is being held in the Westminster City School on Sunday evening, and that's in Palace Street, just off Victoria Street. It'll be at 6:30 for about 2 hours, and Mother is preparing the food for the evening, so it will be a feast in
everything. This is just meant for Sahaja Yogis, because only the Sahaja Yogis can understand the value of this particular program, because it's more the notes and the extension of these notes and the permutations and combinations which we are going to work out. So please inform all the Sahaja Yogis to attend it, even from Brighton and all these places, if they could come, it would be a good idea. As it is, they come for Sunday program, so it would be all right. So, are you all right now?
Oh, yes. I was worried.
No, I know. It is. No, I tell you, it is true. This is such a big book I read. Such a big book. On Kundalini. And the fellow says, perhaps the Kundalini is in the stomach. I said, now what to do? And because it is written down, it's a law. You see, for people, if it is written down, it become a Veda. Then just can't talk to them. He said, but in this book it is written in this. How much does it take to write? In the stomach he writes. Such a big book. And the German. Imagine, supposed to be very meticulous and truthful, writing such a big book and saying that it is in the stomach. When I saw it, I said, and such diagrams. You can't imagine all the diagrams of Grey's Anatomy there everywhere. All sorts of diagrams there. I said, this man, what is he talking? God alone. You see, God is something everybody can use anyway. There's no law against it. You do what you like. People have used God for their own purposes. Is it working out? No? Good. Are you all right? Are you feeling?
I'm not sure where I'm feeling. I'm not
enough. Just you can feel it here, see, if it is not there on the head. Maybe a little hot there. Is it hot?
Warm.
All right. It will cool down. It should cool down a little. Are you all right? Good. Are you?
I have a question.
Huh?
I am a little bit concerned about getting into a state which is so peaceful and so calm that one forgets to do something about the real problems and difficulties which one has to face.
Good idea.
In the sense that if one simply ignores them, they don't just go away, some mad, some warm, will one end up in a worse state in the real world? If one draws in this way.
Now I'll tell you the answer to this, very simple is. Say if you are in the water, and you say the waves coming into you, you are frightened of them. But by some chance, if you get into the boat, you can enjoy them and you can see them. Now it's nice to say that when you are in it, you face them better. Actually, you do not. Because you have no solutions.
No solutions.
You have no solutions. And when you are above them, then only you can solve the problem. To give a very gross analogy, we can say you are going in a car, all right? And something is wrong with the car. You have to get out of it to see. You have to get out of it to see the problem clearly, to solve. If you are in it, you are involved into it, you are biased. You are in fear, you are in trouble, and you can never solve the problem. And then it is even more dangerous, because then you play into the hands of people who have vested interest. They may play about with it and would like to use that to blackmail you, or to trouble you, or to torture you. But in Sahaja Yoga, you don't have to tell me anything. I mean, there are no confessions. I mean, there should be no confessions at all. What is the need to confess? Because I know what the problem is. But I know the problem, and the problem that is at the root of it, at the base of it, which is not yet taken the shape of an actual problem, but where it is really troubling you at the root of it. For example, before the thought rises in you, it is first stirred in the abstract. See? In the same way, the problem is in the abstract. That comes to the gross. So if you can know the problem at the abstract point, you can cure it in a much better way and improve it. But you have to get out of the problem to see it. Your mind has to be out of it to see it, to solve the problem. And then when you are solving it yourself, you are solving it through your ego or superego, you have only two ways. Either you solve it with your aggression or with your depression. There's no way out. But the self has a power of enlightening the whole thing. Like this room is in darkness, for example. One way would be to clean this room or to solve the problem of this room is to aggressively come inside, go like a bull in a china shop, do what you like, hit yourself and get out. Another could be to be afraid of, so come here, get in underneath some one of the chairs, sit there like a rat and get out, thinking maybe that we have faced the problem, but you have not, because there is no light and your eyes are not open. But when the lights are open, you walk in, you know what's the problem, you clear it out. So one must have enlightenment. Without your awareness being enlightened, you cannot find out how to cure yourself, how to get out of the problems. Just see anybody fighting a devil in the dark. You don't know whether you are fighting yourself or the devil. So light is important to see, and that light is the spirit.
That's actualizing
the point. Actualizing. It's not just talking about it. Actualizing. Well, it is there. Actually, it is there. I can see it. It's there. It's to be actualized. And already God has placed within you this power, which is called as Kundalini, which actualizes it. Now, why it rises, awakens? Because something has to happen within you so that your attention is attracted inside. Once your attention is attracted inside, then that attention gets enlightened. Once you get enlightenment, you can feel your own centers. And you talk around, and many people will say, Mother, my right eye is catching. Means my ego. But they don't mind saying that, Mother, I'm getting egoistical. They don't mind saying that. Because they can see themselves. They might say, Mother, my center heart is catching. Means I'm feeling insecure. All right? It has to work out first. You can only have the value of this when you get it. You do not stand on the fence. Just have it. Have you been able to solve your problems? Not so far. So better try this method. It is so dynamic that the problems do not exist. Your priorities change. Then you start solving the problems of others. You become your own master. The situation where somebody who is afraid of a car, then somebody starts learning how to drive a car, and a driver teaching. Then somebody learning how to drive a car. Then after that, the master of the car, you become. You become the master of yourself. Complete master of all the problems you become. And you play them just like a drama. That situation is very much close. Then must you deny it? Tell your mind to understand magnitude of your own capacities, which have not yet manifested. See? They must manifest. You have to know that they have not yet manifested. They must fully manifest. You must find out meaning of your being. You must find out the role of your life. Why are you here? Better now, David. Now put your another hand towards me, the another one. This thing will be better. There are so many ways also to correct yourself in Sahaja Yoga, which you have to try later on. But at the first shot, you do get realization. Then you have to establish yourself. No doubt. No question from any Sahaja Yogi so far? Gavin or someone? They are beyond questions. They are problem solved. David? I have to ask you one question. When are these journalists going to start writing something constructive? Otherwise, they are just waiting for some horrible things to happen and to publish it. How to make these journalists understand that time has come for them to write something that will not shock everyone? Actually, we are under shock because of we read newspapers. I mean, the world is not that bad. Human beings are not so horrid. There may be one ripper here and there, but that is the way they make life so miserable that you find it as if he's hiding here or there, everywhere. Why can't they think that they should publish also something that accomplishes joy and happiness? It's very difficult to understand these people. But I mean, they must have found out also what will they do with all this payment. All their, you see, all they are having strikes, they are closing down most of the newspapers. That means it's not interesting. They have? So one has to see why people do not like them very much now. Because of this, people are fed up. Even from their economics point of view, they should change their trend and their methods and give some good news or some good things. Always bad news doesn't sell. And even this marriage of this lady, it's such a, I can't understand the disgraceful things they are talking. No respect for it. Huh? What? Kundalini, Sushumna. She is asking me a question, does Kundalini passes through all the three nadis or one nadi? It only passes through Sushumna. But the grace flows aren't through these two. Let's see the question. Listen. See the worry. Question is at a different level. See the difference. Attention is somewhere else. So, the new people, all of you have felt cool breeze or not? I don't think you are feeling it. It has to be worked out. What work do you do?
Theater.
Better now? Relaxed? Are you feeling in the hand? Good. This is remote control. Doctor Saab, aapka dekhiye. Aapka dekhiye. आप सवाल पूछे क्या माँ आप महाकाली हैं पूछे
आप महाकाली हैं
क्या माँ आप
क्या माँ आप महाकाली हैं
फिर से यहाँ कैसे रखिए कैसे पूछेगा
क्या माँ आप महाकाली हैं
फिर से
क्या आप माँ महाकाली हैं
आया हाथ है well. Is she feeling this lady who asked the questions? Did you feel any cool breeze? Just put your hands like this, just a little bit. Let's see. You been to some spiritualist?
No.
Never. What work do you do?
Secretary.
Office work. You have to forgive. You have to forgive. All right? Just say, I forgive. That's all. Just see in your heart. You say, I forgive everyone. In your heart. Alaka. It's very subtle. Keep your eyes shut. And it's very subtle. So please pay attention to your fingertips. Pay attention to your heart, to your spirit in your heart, and say that, am I the spirit? Are you feeling? See now, left hand. And you are relaxed. Watch me without thinking. You watch me without thinking. And just keep your eyes open. Watch me without thinking. Better? Are you relaxed? Are you thinking now? Just watch me again. Better. Still better. Yes, it is working out. You see, first day sometimes it doesn't work full way, but it does work out. It's working out now, see. It's very subtle happening, and sometimes it takes 1 or 2 days, 3 days, 4 days.
I have to convince.
You have become what?
I'm a bit of a skeptic. I have to convince. It isn't that I don't believe these things. I have to convince all that.
But what is the use of becoming that?
What?
No use becoming anything. You see, you have to become the self. That's all.
Yeah.
All right? Now keep your mind to that. That you have to become the self. You have to become the spirit. Don't put your mind to anything else. You cannot become anything else but yourself. That's all. All that is myth. All right? Just become the spirit. Tell yourself, I have to be the spirit. I am the spirit. You have to tell yourself. It's important. That helps. Now. Better? May God bless. Is all right now? Can I go? Thank you very much. So for the program, please tell all the people to come down and ask Julie to arrange it. I won't be able to come down there.